Good day to all. This is part 3 of Dual Nature of Radiation and Matter. In the previous sessions, we had seen photoelectric effect, the experimental study, as well as the variation of photocurrent with intensity of light as well as the collector plate potential. In this session, we discuss the topics: the effect of frequency of incident light on stopping potential, as well as photoelectric effect and wave theory of light. Let us see the effect of frequency of the incident radiation on the stopping potential. Here the intensity is kept constant, okay, and the frequency is changed to nu1, nu2 and nu3. That means we are using three types of radiations. We get a graph like this. First, we take radiation with the frequency nu1. We are using the same intensity for three different frequencies. So for the particular intensity, the frequency of the radiation is taken as nu1. Collector plate potential along the positive and negative axis, and photoelectric current along the y axis. With the increase of the collector plate potential, the saturation current has reached the maximum value of the current. As you decrease the collector potential, and the current suddenly stops to zero at a particular value of the collector potential, which is the cutoff potential or the stopping potential, and it is denoted by minus VO or V01. This is for one frequency. We change the frequency to nu2 but kept the intensity as same. Frequency is now changed to another value, the intensity is kept constant, and before, like before, the collector plate potential is varied in the positive direction as well as in the negative direction. But you can see the saturation current is same, but you can see the value of the retarding potential has now increased. The intensity is same, that is why the saturation current is same. Even if the frequencies are different, saturation current remains the same because we use the same intensity radiation. The intensity of the three radiations are kept same. Okay, then what happened here? With the change in frequency, the retarding potential changes. That means as you increase, here you can see nu3 is greater than nu2, which is greater than nu1. So as the frequency of the radiation is increased, the value of the potential required to stop the electron. What happens here? The most energetic electron also comes to rest. So can you relate the energy of the electron with the stopping potential? As the frequency increases, the kinetic energy of the electrons also increases. As the kinetic energy increases, we need more negative potential to repel the most kinetic energetic electron. Here you can see the current depends on the intensity of the light, but the stopping potential is completely independent of the intensity of the light. So these are the observations. Again, we'll go through that again. Frequency is varied, but this intensity is kept the same. Same value of saturation current, but different values of stopping potential for different frequencies. And stopping potential is more and more negative for higher frequencies. Why the stopping potential is more? As I said before, why it is more negative with high frequency? This is an important result we get from this experiment. The energy of the photoelectrons directly depends on the frequency of the incident radiation. Okay, and greater the frequency, greater will be the maximum kinetic energy of the photoelectrons. And hence we need a greater retarding potential to stop the electrons. Now let us see the variation of frequency of incident radiation nu with the stopping potential for different metals. So for different metals, of course, the stopping potential also will be different. Okay, now let us see the variation of stopping potential with the frequency of incident radiation for two different metals, metal A and metal B. The stopping potential increases with the increase in the frequency of the incident radiation. We take the case of metal A. For metal A, you can see that the stopping potential increases with the frequency of the incident radiation, and there is a point on the x-axis where it is marked nu zero, beyond which there is no current. current absorbed. What is that nu zero? That nu zero is nothing but the threshold frequency, the minimum frequency of the incident radiation. So here, as you can see, the frequency is now increased, and when it reached this value, nu zero, the threshold frequency, the photo current starts, and the stopping potential also increases with that. For metal A, this is the minimum threshold frequency, and for metal B, nu zero naught, its threshold frequency. Based on this, we can explain the graph. Stopping potential varies linearly with the frequency of the incident radiation. Stopping potential and kinetic energy you can relate. Okay, as the kinetic energy increases, we need more stopping potential. Stopping potential varies linearly means the maximum kinetic energy of the photoelectrons varies linearly with the frequency of the incident light. It is proven that there is a minimum frequency required for the photoelectron emission to occur. That minimum frequency is called threshold frequency. And for threshold frequency, the stopping potential is zero, means no electrons are emitted, no photocurrent. That is the meaning. Stopping, when the stopping potential is zero, that is the threshold frequency. And after the threshold frequency, the electrons start emitting from the metal surface. So this is a very important conclusion we get from that. The experiment itself had proven that there is the existence of threshold frequency. By studying the variation of photocurrent with the intensity, collector plate potential and frequency of the incident radiation, we can summarize our observations, and it is also called the laws of photoelectric emission. So first of all, it's about the threshold frequency. For photoelectro emission to occur, there should be a minimum frequency for the incident light, and that is actually proven by the experiment. There is the existence of threshold frequency of the incident light below which no photo emission occurs. How intense is the radiation? Then what is the second point? For the incident frequency, greater the threshold frequency, for the incident frequency greater than the threshold frequency, what happens? Photoelectric emission occurs and photocurrent starts recording. Okay, so, and we have found that the photoelectric current is directly proportional to the intensity of the radiation. And what happened after the photocurrent starts above the threshold frequency? The stopping potential or the maximum kinetic energy of the emitted photoelectron directly depends on the frequency of the incident radiation. So once the photoelectric emission starts after the threshold frequency, then it is found that the stopping potential or the maximum kinetic energy of the electron completely depends or linearly depends on the frequency of the incident radiation. Another point is that it is a very instantaneous process. As soon as the light falls on the metal emitter plate, instantly you can see the photocurrent. So it's a very instantaneous process without any time lag. It takes less than 10 raised to minus seconds. So it is a very fast, spontaneous process. So these are the four laws of photoelectric emission. Now let us see why the wave theory failed to explain this photoelectric effect. So according to wave theory, energy is actually in a continuous form. That means there is absorption or emission of energy in a continuous pattern. So the free electrons on the metal surface continuously absorb energy from the incident light. That is according to wave theory. So according to them, as the intensity of the light increases, so for greater intensity of light, greater will be the energy of the photoelectrons. Wave theory related intensity to the energy of the emitted photoelectrons. So, but we have seen that in the experiment that the kinetic energy of the photoelectron has nothing to do with the intensity of the light. It completely depends on the frequency. So this is the failure, first failure. The concept of this continuous absorption of energy proposed by wave theory could not explain the kinetic energy of the photoelectrons. Then, according to wave theory, the intensity is everything, okay? The intensity of the incident radiation is sufficient. If more intense radiation is given, that is sufficient to impart enough energy to the electrons to come out of the metal surface. So there is no existence of this threshold frequency. Threshold frequency is not at all required according to wave theory for the emission of this photoelectrons. This is also, we know, we have seen from the graph that there is an existence of threshold frequency below which no photoelectric emission takes place. So this is also contradicts the experimentally confirmed threshold frequency. Then the third point is that there is continuous absorption of energy by the electrons from the incident light. According to the, what will happen, the energy absorbed per electron per unit time, a single electron absorbing energy turns out to be very small. For a single electron to acquire that enough energy to come out of the metal surface, it takes sometimes hours to pick up that sufficient energy to come out. And that actually contradicts the experimental observation, which says that this photo emission is an instantaneous process which takes less than 10^-9 seconds. So instantaneous. That also could not explain the photoelectric. So this is the failure of the wave theory. Why, according to wave theory, we could not explain photoelectric emission? These are the factors.